my opinion, and I'm a supporter of significant change. But I think we're backing into our corners here a little bit. I do see positive change in the department, and I do see many positive people in the department. I see, having gone with the chief and some others to Philadelphia to the, and I've talked about this, to the International Association of Chiefs of Police conference in the fall. I see, I learned a lot. I learned a lot about how, what the struggles are within the profession, and what the different trends and tendencies and schools of thought are, and where the profession is going. And the influence that, say, President Obama had, 21st century policing, and many other things. I understand that people are grappling with the issues that we're also grappling with in the commission and the community. And at the same time, I do see real concerns. And the one that it comes first to mind is the question of racial disparities in stops, and what's been outlined by the group that the department contracted with to study that, the Center for Policing Equity. You know, in its draft report, talking about use of force disparities and stop disparities and search and so forth. I think those are real issues, and I think that people in the majority community really have to look and see how the experience of policing in communities of color is a different one than what we see. Those are real issues.
But I have a point of order. You know, we're talking here about ways to address police staffing shortages. We're getting off onto personal preferences and all kinds of stuff, but we're on going down the wrong track, I think.
All right, fair enough. These are
related to staffing.
These are policy. These are policy issues. These are not personal issues. There's a lot to talk
perspective,
about.
Personal perspectives.
Everybody has their personal perspective. This is, but thank you for bringing me back to the point. Yes, this is a long and deep conversation. Sergeant and I have talked about getting together. We're going to do that soon. If we're going to have the level of oversight that even the PRC has, we do need to understand what the line officers are going through. And I have a lot of questions about staffing, about, you know, what's appropriate level of staffing, what are the appropriate tasks for the department to be done. I think the question about what can be reassigned to other non-sworn staff of the city is a valuable question. But I'm not saying that any one thing is going to solve the problem. I think we're going to have to look at these things honestly and dispassionately and together, jointly.
All right. Sorry, in the interest of time, I'm just
going to
take one more comment.
I think this is we need to continue to carry on this dialogue. Just one of the things I would say to Sergeant Bross, I have always tried to make, and I think the Chief touched on a little bit too, I've always tried to make a distinction between the Berkeley Police Department and policing nationwide. And when you said negative, I forget how you put it, negative things happen around the country. It affects the institution. When it was a sexual assault case in Cincinnati, affects the Catholic Church worldwide, people's perceptions of it. I think she was talking about the 90s, and I think that was a good period, but I think there's a date that changed everything, and that's 9/11. And we are asking you guys to say, protect us, you know, do the best you can, and we're completely aware of Columbine, Parkland, and everything that's happened in between. We're aware of Nice and Paris and Barcelona. So So we, I'm, as one person, completely aware that if we wound up with a Barcelona-type situation, a me situation, I'd want my police with all the capability they needed to deal with that situation. On the other hand, democracies around the world have been shrinking in their numbers. And those that still call themselves democracies, people are desperately defending democracies. And when people, particularly Berkeley, being the unique political town it has been in its history, when I do not use these words in pejorative terms, when you have Nazis and fascists in the highest levels of office in this country, people are scared.
Where's that point of order?
Okay, and that gets into the militarization thing. That's all I want to say. That's a whole further discussion, but I don't want to go on forever.
All right. I'm going to end discussion there in the interest of time, but I would like to encourage all commissioners to think about what's been said today and come back next meeting with tangible solutions and how we can approach this issue. So we will now move into public comment. Was there anyone who would like to speak? Yes.
I've been coming to several meetings here and listening to the conflict between the PRC and the police. And it's very disconcerting to me. We need the police to police our communities. And, you know, we need for the police to be able to defend themselves and have the training they need to do that. And in order to go home, like Chief said. You're talking about possibly making a charter to have control over the police, and you guys were discussing it, but they're sitting right here, and they have opinions about it, and nobody asks them anything about it. And it's kind of frustrating because we're all in the same room, and we all have to get along, and we all are trying to do our jobs. So I'm just wondering, why can't we have that communication happen here? Why can't we say, you know, what are the problems? What do you see the problems as being with this that's being brought in front of us? You know, I'm just trying to make some kind of bridge here.
Thank you. So I came here because I was concerned about staffing, and I was glad that it was on your agenda, but there were no ideas for how you are going to support staffing. So what I saw is you guys got gaslit tonight. I read the PRC ordinance at 6 o'clock this evening, and then I came to this meeting at 7, and I'm thumbing through this thing, and I'm a quick study, so I find this thing that people of City of Berkeley adopt as follows, and I read it and I started marking it up, and I thought, what is this? Is this what the PRC is now? And then the agenda item came and I realized, no, this is only a proposal. Thank God this isn't what the PRC is now. And I went straight to what you highlighted when you spoke, which was, this commission shall have the power to review and modify all written and unwritten policies, practices, and procedures of whatever kind and without limitation in relation to the Berkeley Police Department. And then I watched 2 hours of completely dysfunctional conversation. I want to say I am so not interested in you assuming the responsibility of trained professionals. I don't want to be a guinea pig in your weird thing you've got going on. I want professionals to run it. I elected a council. I live in a city with a city manager, and I'm not interested in you trying to subvert that. And the idea in it's actually fundamentally un-American that you would take a police role or a, don't laugh and you listen, because you space out and go like this whenever anybody else is talking, and I don't even know you, and I've just identified you in 2 hours as a major source of the problem here, and I don't even know who you are. So she just proposed, she gaslit you all.
That's violent.
She subverted your own commission, and she wrote something, I think it was her, and maybe you too, wrote a proposal for you know what the future of the PRC could be. But there was no conversation here. And then she tried to make you say, and she got you to do it, that your subcommittee would focus on her words. Now, that's like an attorney's ploy where you write the first document, and it's a way of getting control and shaping a conversation. So you all just got gaslit. And this night has freaked me out. You have all freaked me out. And the idea that you would take a function like a police department, public safety, and put it outside of the pyramid of local governance, think about that. Would we take the military and put it outside the pyramid of the elected officials? No, we would never do anything like that. We wouldn't take policing and put it outside the realm of the elected structure or outside of the control of the professionals. So I don't know what's going on here, but this was a really freaky night, and I'm leaving here really upset. I came here to be encouraged about staffing, and I don't know what's going on, but these are nice folks. I've talked to some people at the coffee with a cop, and I'm really happy with my police department. And I don't know what this was about. I think some of you have a better idea, and some of you are trying to address it, and some of you, I don't know what you're doing.
So I'm going to ask for a future public comment that we don't talk about personal commissioners. Yes?
I wanted to talk about the issue of support. Like, I had a medical test today, and I suspect that it'll be fine. There's still that uncertainty. And I thought about all the people that I know in the Bay Area and who I wanted to spend my time tonight with, and I wanted it to be Ross and the Chief. Those are the two people that I felt that tonight I should be around, because they do support me, and I support them. And I feel like other people should try to find their own way of supporting each other. And like, I also wanted to say that it was disappointing, and the reason why I came here tonight was because I saw that the police chaplain program was on the agenda, and I recall that that was my idea, and I'm kind of disappointed that that was not discussed tonight, because again, the concept of that is support, not only support for the police, but support for the community. And someone whose job it would be to be a bridge between the community and the police. And so I hope the next time that is prioritized. In terms of perks, like she said, no one talked about coming up with ideas for how to get police to want to be here. And Berkeley is such a wonderful city, and there are so many great aspects of the city. So how can the police tap into those assets? One thing I was thinking of earlier today was, like, the police station is so close to the Berkeley Art Museum, and maybe the department can come up with a program with the UC where Berkeley cops have free tickets to go in during their lunch hour or just during their days off, and something to calm down, to look at art, and to tap into the humanities aspect of being a human being. And and then also the housing issue, that's gonna be a regional issue, and maybe the city of Berkeley needs to talk with two other cities about it. There's new housing in Walnut Creek, there's new housing in Concord, so maybe the Berkeley can talk to those other cities to try to find a way of housing people relatively close to Berkeley so they're not driving all the way from Sacramento and then back to Sacramento when their shift is over.
Yes.
All right, I wasn't gonna speak. I just wanted to come and see how this works. Because I was mainly concerned about staffing. All of a sudden I've had a couple of incidents where I had to call the police in my neighborhood, which is generally pretty safe. And I've talked to some of the police, like it's the most relevant and stuff like that, and I understand the concerns the sergeant outlined from that was pretty much across the board. And I need to tell you as a citizen, Berkeley, since the eighth grade, that I perceive a real strong anti-police bias that I've never seen before. And I think that's got to affect staffing. And I would ask you guys to consider what role you play in that, because my perception is that's part of the problem. And I want to thank you three guys for being Berkeley police officers. It's a tough job.
How long do we have? I would really like to address Sergeant Moss's wish list. I would hope you will be paid more money so that you can buy places in the city or places in the city. But what I'm really concerned about is how can we reopen the subject of canines? I read Norm Stamper's book, To Protect and Serve, and he goes through, he has an entire chapter on tools, and he very specifically talked about different functions of police dogs. For a patrol officer, not only are dogs faster in protecting your life, they can do things you cannot possibly do with a taser. But what he says, when he was the chief of police in San Diego, they got 40 new canine dogs. The officer involved shootings went way down if the dogs are properly trained and properly deployed. They can hold someone. This is not being used as attack dogs. It seems to me from this description, they're much safer to a person than being tased. Because there's being tased, that is still kind of a wild card. There are more and more recommendations against it. You can't use tasers in a lot of situations. And tasers make crazy people crazier, which sounds really bad to me for Berkeley. But I know dogs push people's buttons. They have been misused against crowds. He advises strongly against using them ever for riot control, allowing them to be used as attack dogs. But I would really like to see the city revisit this possibility because it could make so much difference in an officer's safety and the safety of the general public. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any more public comments? All right, if not, we'll be moving into closed session. I would like to
thank everyone. I have one point that if I could just raise for the agenda for next time on item 9E. Can you please move that up on the agenda? You know, we're talking about morale issues and stuff like that, and yet we keep passing this over. You know, we have a lot of cops out there doing a lot of good things, and we read those reports, and we're not acknowledging them.
That's true.
Okay.